ओम श्री साई राम। माय हम्बल प्रणाम्स एट द लोटस फीट ऑफ माय डियरेस्ट भगवान श्री सती साई बाबा। माय सिंसियर थैंक्स टू श्री कृष्णमूर्ति जी फॉर दिस वंडरफुल इनिशिएटिव ऑफ क्रिएटिंग अ प्लेटफॉर्म टू गिव अपॉर्चुनिटी टू ऑल द चिल्ड्रन एंड यूथ टैलेंट्स ऑल ओवर द वर्ल्ड। आई एम रियली ग्रेटफुल फॉर दिस। एंड टुडेज टॉपिक विल बी द इम्पॉर्टेंस ऑफ प्रेयर्स। WHO defines health as a state of physical, emotional, mental, social and spiritual well-being. As a qualified medical practitioner, I was concentrating on the first three aspects of physical, emotional and mental well-being and giving this support for this well-being. But when I retired, by my Guru's grace, I realized that by merely having a spiritual well-being, you can achieve all the other four very easily. So with His grace, I do research with the scriptures and His teachings, and I like to share this thoughts with children and youth in various places. And I'm thankful to Krishnamurti ji for this opportunity, because today I'm going to share the importance of prayers with the youth of the world. It is said that to grow an oak tree, we have to plant an acorn. Similarly, for a future society to be peaceful and happy, we need to develop a value system for the children and instill the values in them. Among the values to be instilled first, that is, children have to be made to understand that God, the Paramatma, created the universe and all the living beings and also the inanimate things. Being the creator, He is also the sustaining power of life, and He provides with everything needed for the well-being of His creations. They should be very well assured about this point, that Paramatma is the creator. Second point they should imbibe is, they should imbibe the principle of their religion they follow. What is religion? Religion means ligate means tie back. Even as doctors, we say when we do surgery, we ligated this artery, I mean we tie down. So what are we trying to tie down? What is the religion trying to tie us down? We came from the Paramatma, He is the source, and we have to go back to Him. We have to be tied back to the Paramatma. So the religion shows the pathways how we have to reach the Paramatma. God is the basis of all religion, and reaching Paramatma is the goal of all religion, and also the essence of all religion is the prayers. Among the prayers, Omkara, the Om, is very powerful mantra. When God created this universe, the first sound which emerged was Om. And so it is called as primordial sound or the pranava. When science says there's a big bang theory, there was a big sound and that. Why is it so powerful? Because it permeates into every atom and as every cell of His creation. So it's a very powerful mantra. Imagine a child who's just 10 months old, is trying to learn how to walk. We help them by giving a stand with three wheels. The child stands behind and holding the wheel and tries to move. Similarly, the pathway of spirituality, the three-syllable Om with A, U and Ma is going to be our guide to hold and follow it into the spiritual pathway. That's how the Omkar is very important.
नित्यं ध्यायन्ति योगिनः कामदं मोक्षदं चैव ओंकाराय नमो नमः.
And now, after every prayer has got this omkara in it. So the prayers can be classified into two groups. The first group is called shlokas or stotra. They are adoration of gods. Remember, bhakti itself is called adoration. We have to adore the creator who has given us so many things. So we, what do we adore? His superior powers, his compassion, his love and joy. And finally, we express a gratitude through shlokas or stotras. And what does the second group mean, prarthana? Prarthana means praying to God for any protection, for guidance, for boons, whether for materialistic purpose, physical purpose, or even for spiritual purpose. Who else we will ask? We will have to ask the Creator to guide us. And prarthana is a call from the devotees who have strong faith and confidence that He is going to guide us and lead us into the pathway. As He has already proved in Mahabharata, you have seen Lord Krishna was a charioteer of Arjuna, whose other name is Partha. So he is named Parthasarathi. Likewise, the Lord will be the charioteer of our journey in this earth. Just as food is necessary for nourishing the physical body, prayers are very essential for the nourishment of the soul and the mind. They lift our mind and soul up. If the mind and soul are concentrating on material needs, like desires and so many other needs, it will be leading into a bondage. You will get bonded into something and fan all the six enemies which are obstacles in our spiritual pathway. What are they? Kama, Krodha, Moga, Lobha, Madha, Matsari. So you will be attached in a bondage, and if it is not fulfilled, you will get anger, and then one leads to another chain reactions. On the other hand, when you do the prayers, it will lift away from the material needs, and this is called upliftment towards the God. Even the food what we cook has to be offered to the Lord as bhog, and they also get sanctified and they energize us. And there's a food prayer which everyone should learn and chant.
Harir Data, Harir Bhokta, Harir Annam Prajapatihi, Harir Vipra Charirastu, Bhumte Bhojayate.
When the kitten mews, meow, 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 what happens? The mother cat runs wherever she is. She is tuned to her kitten, and she knows the kitten has got some needs or she is in danger, so she rushes and helps to protect. Similarly, once you start praying constantly, you establish a direct connection with God. In fact, prayers are direct communication with the God, like hotlines, what we say. The heads of the states of big nations, they have hotline. They don't have to dial and all that. They take and they'll be connected to that. Similarly, prayers will connect you directly to the Lord. And when you are in trouble and tell the name from your heart, He rushes. You have known the story of Prahlad. Prahlad was tortured even by his own father for chanting the name of Narayana.
Om Namah Narayana. Narayana.
and he was pushed from the mountain once, set on fire, elephants were sent to trample him, but what gave him the strength and he was fearless, it was the prayers. He kept on chanting and he was very, very sure that Lord is going to come and save him. And finally, Lord Narayana took the form of Narasimha and protected him and killed the people torturing him. Not only for humans, God responds to the cries of even the other creations. Take for instance the story of Gajendra, the elephant, whose feet was held by the crocodile, and he prayed to Lord Narayana and Narayana saved him. You know all the stories. And Draupadi, in Mahabharata, you know, the Kauravas were trying to disrobe her in public and dishonor her. She entered there, the court, and she saw great people like Bhishma, Drona and so many others who never took a step to protect her. But when she chanted Dwaraka Nilaya Achyudhan, she cried to Krishna. Krishna helped her by sending saris and yards of saris to prevent her being disrobed and saved her honor. God responds to the sincere prayers. And this pathway of praying to God is called bhakti. And what is bhakti? Bhakti is called love for the divine. Bhakti is like a magnet. Like magnet will draw the iron filings, bhakti will draw the devotee towards the Lord. It is different between the magnet and one way. The Lord also is drawn toward the devotee. The devotee will be drawn towards the Lord. And through the bhakti, what the devotee shows, the Lord also is drawn towards the bhaktas. So, Bhagavan Baba says, hold fast to your Ishta Devata's name, whichever name, be it Shiva, Rama, Krishna, Ganesha, hold on to the name and the form it indicates. Dwell, Smarana, dwell on the name and the form in all your acts and deeds, as long as in your awakened state or even the sleeping state. Keep chanting, because in Kali Yuga the surest royal road to divine is Namasmaran. There's a story behind this boon, because it was Kali Purushan who was given this boon, that unlike in Treta and Dwapara Yuga, where people have to go towards divinity, they have to perform a very big rituals like havans and homams, and they have to read elaborate chanting of scriptures and other things. Because of one incident, Kali Purushan gave this boon. This is told in Bhagavatam. And you know, Sukamuni, he was discussing Bhagavatam with the other saints in Naimisharanya. He was telling the story of Parikshit that time. Parikshit was the grandson of Arjuna and son of Abhimanyu. And he was ruling the entire earth that time. He was a very good emperor. He used to go and disguise in the night around his kingdom to see how his citizens are faring. On one particular day when he was coming in disguise, he saw two cows, each with only one leg, and they were standing. They were being tortured by an ugly looking person. Parikshit knew the animal language, so he understood these two cows are dharmas and they are being tortured by none other than Kali Purusha. He got very angry and he told Kali Purusha, I'll throw you out of my kingdom. Kali Purusha laughed. He said, King, every place, nook and corner is ruled by you. Where are you going to throw me? I'll give you a suggestion. Give me a small place. I'll go there and you see that your citizens don't come near me, I will not trouble. Parikshit thought it was a good suggestion, so he said, okay, wherever wrong things are being happening, where people are cheating, there's no harmony, where there's gambling, where the women are doing immoral things, you go and stay there. Again, Kali Purusha laughed. He said, in this yuga, these are very, very few places. I'm very big, I need little more space. Unlike in Kali Yuga, which is enormous, in those days it was a very small place. So, in exchange, I'll give you a boon. I'll give you a boon that in Kali Yuga, the citizens or the humans don't have to do elaborate rituals or yagas or reading the scriptures. Merely chanting the Lord's name will put them into the path of divine. It will be a royal road. This is the offer he gave. So Parikshit took that offer and allowed him to go and stay in places where there's a lot of gold and people who are craving for gold go and occupy. What happened? King normally has a lot of gold, so Kalipursha occupied in his palace also. Next day when Parikshit went on a hunting spree, it was under the influence of Kali. He picked up a dead snake and threw it on a meditating rishi, and the sun cursed him to death. Kali started his action there itself. A very interesting incident I want to share with you. This is in Ramayana. Rama had finished his Vanavasa and came back and had Pattabhishekam, and he was living in the palace. And one day he was walking along the river Saryu, which is near Ayodhya, and he just picked up a small pebble and he threw into the waters of Saryu. What happened to it? Sank down. Then a thought arose in his mind. A small pebble sank, but the Vanaras, huge heavy boulders, and the sea to build the Rama Setu bridge to go to Lanka to bring back Sita Ma. How did they do it? They didn't sink at all. And you know, Hanuman exhibited Dasya Bhakti. He used to follow him like a shadow. So he turned back and looked at Hanuman, and Hanuman understood what was going in Rama's mind. He told Rama, "Rama, you may be the Lord, but the name of the Lord is more powerful than you. Your name, Rama, is more powerful than you. Our Vanara scribbled Rama on every boulder. That's how it floated and we could attain what we wanted."
Rama.
Another incident was about Krishna. Janabai was an uneducated servant who lived in Pandharpur. She used to do domestic chores and earn money. She was very poor, and one thing was she used to chant the name of Vittal for every deed she did. Every deed. So she used to say Vittala, Vittala, Vittala. Even when she was making the cow dung. Those days cow dung cakes were made, and they used to light it in the kitchen and cook food on that. They never had this gas or electrical inductions, etc. So they used to use this cow dung. And whenever she used to lit the cow dung, she used to make cow dung chanting Vitala's name. And when she lit the cow dung cake and cooked, the cow dung cake was echoing Vitala, Vitala, Vitala. That was
Vitala Hari Vitala. Vittala Vittala Nama Bajo Hari Vittala Panduranga Vittala 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 Nama Panduranga Vittala 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 Nama Vittala Vittala Nama Bajo Hari Vittala 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 Nama Bajo Hari Vittala Vittala Vittala
was the power of the mantra and the sincerity of the bhakta. So the Lord says, I don't reside in Vaikuntha. I reside wherever my name is sung from the heart. This story explains that. Another episode from Sitamma and Rama's story. And Sita enjoyed a lot of time in the palace with Rama, and Rama used to give her all the attention. But the moment Hanuman enters the room, all his attention will be diverted towards Hanuman. It happened once, it happened twice. Sita was patient, but it repeated many times. Then one day she couldn't take it. She told Rama, "What is that? Why is that? You are talking to me, but when Hanuman comes, everything goes towards Hanuman." And Rama smiled and said, "I'll explain to you. Come." He took her and plucked a small hair from his hand, Hanuman's hand, and kept it near the ear. And what did she hear? "Ram, Ram, Ram, Ram."
"Ram, Ram, me Ram rakha bajrang bale. Ram, Ram, me doob gaya bajrang bale. Ram, Ram, me Ram rakha bajrang bale. Ram, Ram, me doob gaya bajrang bale."
That's what Rama said. His bhakti is too much, even his strand of hair is chanting my name and is attracting me. I'm not doing it deliberately. His bhakti is pulling me and drawing attention from away from you to him. Such is the power of bhakti. Another great bhakt. This great bhakts have just chanted name and attained the Lord. One such saint is Meera. Meera had to undergo a lot of torture because she was constantly chanting Krishna, Krishna, and she used to forget her household chores. She derived lot of pleasure chanting the Krishna. Her husband did not understand, her in-laws did not understand. She went torture, and finally she attained what she wanted. Krishna embraced her and took her into him by merely chanting.
Achyutam Keshavam Krishna Damodaram Janaki Vallabham Ramanarayanam Achyutam Keshavam Krishna Damodaram Janaki Vallabham Ramanarayanam. Kon kehte
Very interesting stories about Shabari. You must have heard. She was an Adivasi lady. She was serving in Madanga Munivar's ashram. She was helping out the ashram. And she used to listen to the lectures or talks which Madanga Munivar used to give his disciples. On one day, Madanga Munivar said, "Lord Narayana is ready to descend as an avatar. Rama avatar is going to happen and he'll be the king of Ayodhya. And he will pass by through the forest also." This she heard and she caught it. She started imagining that Rama is going to come, and the avatar had not taken place, but she started imagining and he is going to come, and she had to offer something. So she used to collect the wild berries in the forest, taste it and preserve the good ones, waiting for Rama to come. Of course, Rama avatar did happen, and during that Vanavasa time, Rama's route was not diagonally opposite route he was supposed to take, but her bhakti was so powerful, as I told you, like a magnet, it pulled him towards her, and she offered the fruit, and what she wanted was mukti, and she reached the God by simply chanting the name Rama, Rama, Rama again.
Kon kehte bhagwan khate nahi, kon kehte bhagwan khate nahi, phir shabari ke jaise khilate nahi, phir shabari ke jaise khilate nahi.
So prayers, I said, should emanate from the heart, and the heart should be very pure. This is what is the main condition for it to easily connect to the Lord. The second thing is prayer should be offered with one-pointed attention. This we all know Guru Nanak Ji is a big saint, and he was contemporary to Emperor Akbar. When Emperor Akbar was ruling, Saint Guru Nanak also had taken avatar, and he was present in the mosque where on one particular day when Lord Akbar was giving his namaz, prayers. When he started chanting his namaz, Guru Nanak Ji laughed. The emperor stopped and looked at him, "What's wrong with you?" And Guru Nanak Ji said, "What is the use of your prayer? Your lips are chanting the prayer. Your mind was always in this Arabian horses. You got lovely Arabian sturdy horses you got as gifts yesterday. And you're concentrating on that and you're chanting the name. This is not done." So we have to be, our mind will try to wander, but we try to bring it to the place and say the prayers from the heart. And prayer should be made as a daily habit, a constant habit. We have to wake up in the morning and look at our hands and say the morning prayer. And whenever you eat, you offer the food prayer. And whatever chore you do, you chant the prayer inside, not necessarily loud, inside your heart. You keep chanting and offer it, all the fruits of the chores, to the Lord, the indweller. And in the night, give a prayer of gratitude for having given you a wonderful day, and go to sleep. We as Indians have the richest legacy in the world. We have great sages and saints who have composed lovely hymns and songs and have they given to us. One such example is Adi Shankara. He has composed innumerable hymns and songs and sotras against various forms of gods and goddesses. One such sloka is Annapurnashtakam. When he composed this Annapurnashtakam, he physically had the darshan of goddess Annapurni, and he was able to compose it describing her glory.
Annapurne sadha purne Shankara pranavallabe Jnana vairagya siddhyartham Vikshan dehi cha parvati.
What a powerful sloka it must be. It drew even a goddess Annapurni, and he was physically saying. In another instance, he was in Kerala, he went for a bhiksha, because saints used to get bhiksha and eat. They never used to have money and buy food. They used to, whoever gives them as bhiksha, they used to take whatever they get, they will eat. Went to a house of a poor lady. She had only one gooseberry, and she gave that to the saint. He was moved by it, and so he prayed to Goddess Lakshmi to remove the poverty of that lady, poor lady. So he composed this Kanakadharasas. Goddess Lakshmi appeared and poured golden gooseberries. We had permission of that. Such is the power of the slokas, and we are blessed to have these slokas which we should learn and chant, which is going to help everyone. These are all not divine leelas meant only for few people. It is for who follow the one-pointedness, attention, the love of God, and chant with the faith and confidence. It will manifest whatever legitimate, whatever is due to you, the God will definitely provide. Again, Vishnu Sahasranama. This was chanted by Bhishma when he was on the bed of bows. The bed of bow was made by Arjuna because he was waiting for the Uttarayana to come to leave his body. At that time, he sang the glory of Vishnu. This Sahasranama means 1008 shlokas. He chanted, Vedavyasa dictated and Ganesha had written, and there were other people who were listening to it, other than Pandavas and others, who Lord Goddess Parvati and Shiva, they were also listening to this Sahasranama when it was composed. So after it was composed, Goddess Parvati, being the mother, asked Lord Shiva, "Lord, 1008 namas is so difficult for my children. Only the great pandits and scholars can chant. and you are giving so many benefits. I want each and everyone to receive this benefit. What is the easiest way? He no paina lakuna. Lagu means easy. Give a easy way. Okay. Give one upayam, which is very easy. And Ishvara gave a upayam. And he said, chant this loka, you will get all the benefits of chanting 1008 names.
Shri Rama Rama Rameti Rame Rame Mano Rame Sahasranama Tatulyam Rama Nama Varanane.
See what grateful the Creator is. All is required is just to take one step and do it. Similarly, another greatest Sahasranama was Lalita Sahasranama. Goddess Shakti, she wants to give the powers to all her children. Mother, no, it's overflowing love. So she wants to give. So what she said, this was told by Hayagriva to Agastya, that Shakti wanted to give all the benefits of this, her names. So she made Devadas called Vak Devadas to write to her 1008 names, which are powerful, to enable the bhakta to chant and get all the boons. So they give you the way, they give you the upayam, and all is required is we have to understand the benefits and believe in it with faith and start chanting. So prayers can make our life as a grand pilgrimage. So an old lady, this is a small story in the modern world, an old lady, very peaceful, very beautiful. She was very old. She was in 90s. But she was glowing. We call it Tejas. You've seen the saints and sages, they glow because of the power of the mantras. This lady was glowing, and some of them went and asked, Auntie, you're glowing like this. What cosmetics are you using to make your skin glow? She said, surely I use cosmetics. I'll tell you what it is. She said, for the lips, I use a cosmetic of truth. For the voice, I use a cosmetic of prayer. For the eyes, the compassion and pity for the suffering. And for the hands, the charity. And the heart, I love all the creations of God. And this is the short formula for the Creator expects from us. When another incident in the contemporary age, when someone asked George Washington, an American president who was very successful, what is the secret of your success, sir? George Washington said, I pray as if everything depends on God. He paused and then he continued. He said, I work as if everything depends on me. That is my focus on the job. That is the secret of success. So it is very beautifully explained in this, in Hindi, Hath me kaam, man me raam. So keep chanting and chanting.
Krishna Govind Gopal gaate chalo, Krishna Govind Gopal gaate chalo, naam japte chalo, kaam karte chalo, naam japte chalo, kaam karte chalo.
My dear children, prayers will be your best companion, protector and guide in your life's journey, and you get all your life, you get bliss and happiness. And thank you for this opportunity given.
Janaki Vallabham.
Krishna Damodaram Janaki ജനകീ വല്ലഭം രാമനാരായണം അച്യുതം കേശവം കൃഷ്ണദാം.